Radio Algeria International presents International Politico, a weekly program hosted by Lasfer Mazari.
Professor Henning Melberg, senior advisor of the Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation and of the Nordic Africa Institute, extraordinary professor of political science, University of Pretoria, and the Center for Africa Studies, University of the Free State in Bloemfontein. Melberg has been following Namibia's political development for years. Professor Melberg, welcome to our program.
Thank you very much.
In Namibia, the South West Africa People Organization, SWAPO, won general elections held last November with presidential candidate Hage Geingob winning nearly 87% of the vote. Mr. Geingob, now Prime Minister, will be sworn in as President of Namibia in March 2015. First, tell us, Professor, about the South West Africa People Organization, SWAPO Party, which has been in power since 1990. In the last elections in 2009, SWAPO won 54 seats.
Well, this latest result is the best result SWAPO ever achieved. Mm-hmm. Ever since the first elections after decolonization, meaning going back in 1994, SWAPO had obtained a two-thirds majority, which then became 70 and well above 70% majority. And this time it's for the first time that SWAPO as a party got 80%, which only partly is a result of the good governance and the delivery of the party. It's as much the result of the lack of any meaningful and efficient opposition in the country. So with enemies like the current opposition parties, you don't really need friends. They play into the hands of a very strong party, which is, by the way, basically a de facto one-party dominance in the country ever since independence. But
which
similarly,
President-elect
Hage Geingob, scored with 86%, clearly more votes than any of his two predecessors, meaning the founding father, Sam Nujoma, who was heading the liberation movement since its establishment, and then Hifikepunye Pohamba, who is currently still in office and hands over to Hage Geingob. For Geingob, I think the additional votes were partly a result that he is for the first time a candidate not coming from the majority population in the densely populated northern part of Namibia. So many of those who did not feel represented in ethnical terms by the two successors now also voted for Geingob, who is also having the title of being a unifier. But he still has to show that he deserves that programmatic title.
He's from a Damara community and known as Omaki, which means unifier, as you said it.
Well, that is correct. Yeah.
Yeah. What explains such popularity of the SWAPO party?
First of all, SWAPO has been the only internationally recognized liberation movement. That's a marked contrast to other liberation movements in Southern Africa. Mm-hmm. And it was already in the mid-1970s recognized by the General Assembly of the United Nations as, I quote, the sole and authentic representative of the Namibian people. So the slogan during the struggle days that SWAPO is the nation and the nation is SWAPO has very much been internalized by the Namibian population and electorate ever since independence. And SWAPO still can sail under the flag that we are the liberators. Interesting enough, they don't need to do that any longer that much. Even now, a generation into independence, where we have a considerable number of so-called born frees voting now, they also vote for SWAPO, because at the same time, given the dominance of SWAPO, you have this equation that the party is the government and the government is the state. So everything the state does in terms of infrastructure investment, improving of living conditions, as modest as it might be, is equated with SWAPO policy. And the SWAPO election manifesto for these elections and the campaign clearly also emphasized that equation, that SWAPO is the state and the state is supposed to serve the Namibian people, meaning in return that SWAPO serves the Namibian people. It's almost a knee-jerk response that the population still identifies with SWAPO. To some extent also, however, because of the absence of any strong political opposition which would have any meaningful political alternatives.
Let's talk about the opposition. The Democratic Turnhull Alliance, or the DTA of Namibia, won 4.8% of the vote.
That came as a surprise, especially because the DTA was considered to be the pro-South African party at independence. It then scored considerably more, far above 20%, and was since then, the last 25 years, in constant decline. It was not any longer the official opposition for the last two periods in parliament, and it regained a few votes, which makes it now the official opposition party with most seats among the few seats of the opposition parties in parliament. To some extent, the explanation is that they have a dynamic younger leader who comes from the Herero-speaking community, who seems to be very popular and seems to have managed to attract new votes by people who do not want to vote for SWAPO and in the absence of other alternatives now voted for DTA. He, during the election campaign, very spectacularly and slightly controversially decided to live for a few days in the township of Katutura, the township of Windhoek, in a shack to make the point that he wants to find out how the ordinary people in Namibia are living, because Namibia, as we talk, still has the biggest income discrepancies in the whole world as a society. So a lot of people, despite it being a relatively rich country, live in abject poverty. Now, that was a very populist move. It was a clever move, and I think it added to the votes he managed to get back for the DTA.
Yeah, but Bagengob promised to serve all Namibians.
He has to live up to that promise, and that will be the decisive aspect when he takes over the office. There is a lot of frustration growing on the grassroots level in the urban areas where people see that there is a new privileged minority elite which is in political offices or related to the political office bearers, while too little, according to their expectation, has changed for them as ordinary people. And I think the pressure is on Geingob with high expectations that he has to deliver. It cannot continue to be an elite project. They need to redistribute part of the wealth.
He ensured that no Namibians are left out of national development process. Well, adding to that, he would also work with the opposition parties.
I think Geingob is very enlightened. He is a clever strategist. He is conceptually sound. He's an intellectual. He did, while he was prime minister, a PhD at the University of Leeds in the UK. So he is very well equipped. He has an analytical mind. And I think he indeed sees the challenges and knows that he has to live up to it. And it really is the hope of the Namibian people that this will happen.
Well, observers such as CADC, the African Union and European Union gave the vote their stamp of approval. What can you say, Professor, about that? So this is the CIDC election observers mission led by South African Minister of International Relations and Cooperation, Maite Nkoana Mashabane. He noted that the period before, during and after the elections was generally peaceful with isolated cases of intimidation.
Indeed, and that was a very positive development. There were even much lesser cases of modest violence. If we say violence, then it's actually shuffling around of persons. We are talking about really fundamentally peaceful elections in Namibia all the times, but this time even more peaceful than the last ones. It was really remarkable, and it was the most welcome development that hardly anything happened in terms of even verbal tensions. But again, one of the factors that explaining that is the absence of any meaningful challenge. A party as dominant as SWAPO can afford to respond with tolerance and with lenience to political opposition parties who are not representing any risk or any danger to undermine the dominance. So that's the one thing. The other thing is that such a dominant party is, of course, operating in an environment which is not truly fair. It might be free because they can operate as they like, but it's not really fair. To give you one particular example, the last political rally that SWAPO held the weekend before the elections took place was broadcasted live in the national television, the state-owned television. And SWAPO said they had paid for the television time. Mm-hmm. But if you translate that into other democracies, it's unheard of that a political party could rent state-owned television time to broadcast its last political rally for hours into the rooms of the electorate. And it's only SWAPO that, even if they paid, could afford to pay that. There's no other party that comes close to that. And as a result, from taxpayers' money, parties subsidies according to the amount of votes. Now you can imagine the party that scores 80% of the votes gets 80% of all the money, which adds to its predominance. And to that extent, one needs to be careful to call the elections free and fair with reference to fair, because the level playing field is not even.
But the strongest support came from the United States, which congratulated the people of Namibia for exercising their democratic right to vote.
Yeah, well, I mean, the Western countries, if you allow me that, with some slight amusement, have no reasons to be critical of SWAPO, because since independence, SWAPO and the Namibian government lived up to the expectations that this was a decolonization process of controlled change, which then resulted in changed political control, but to a large extent, the maintenance of the status quo. We have the very same international mining companies and fishing companies that plunder the Namibian resources as they used to be before independence, only that they now have new competitors to deal with. That means new companies coming from China, from India, and from other parts of the world. But it's business as usual. So why should a U.S. government be in any way critical of such a result?
Professor, tell us about the e-vote, which is the first case in Africa.
That was a success?
Was it a success?
No, I'm afraid it was not. It was, again, the overambitious attitude of the Namibian Electoral Commission, the ECN. Mm-hmm. They had changed the Electoral Act. The Parliament has changed the Electoral Act when they adopted a new law in August of this year, which introduced electronic voting machines. But when adopting the act, it said they also want to have a paper trail, because they wanted to counteract the suspicions that electronic voting machines might be vulnerable to manipulations. And if we only recall elections in the so-called cradle of democracy, the USA, and in Florida, then we know that electoral voting machines are no guarantee for non-manipulative elections. It's the opposite. So to learn from that, actually, Parliament adopted an electoral act which said electoral voting machines, yes, but with a paper trail, which gives evidence to the voter that his or her vote was cast for exactly the party he or she wanted to vote for. Now it turned out that the voting machines delivered from India were technologically not yet up to the standard and could not be delivered together with a paper trail. So strictly speaking, the electoral voting machines that were used in the Namibian elections were a violation of the electoral law. But that was not all of the story. The other part was that the personnel that was supposed to operate the voting machines did not manage. Mm-hmm. So in many of the polling stations, there were delays for hours before the people could vote. And then the voting act took longer than if they would have casted a paper ballot. As a result, by the end of the day, when the polling stations were supposed to close, you had long queues of people who were still denied their right to vote. Some of the polling stations were open until the next morning, and reportedly mm-hmm. several thousand, if not more, of the electorate who wanted to vote were sent mm-hmm. back home without being able to vote.
Mm-hmm. Professor, how about economy? In 2013, global business and financial news provider Bloomberg named Namibia the top emerging market economy in Africa and the 13th best in the world. Tell us something about that.
Well, Namibia is a so-called higher middle-income country. It is rich of natural resources. It's especially the mining sector, a little bit of fisheries as well, and then tourism. You have a lot of foreign interests. You have very little to almost no manufacturing, meaning value-added industry, but it's a good investment for external interests. It fits nicely into this so-called success story of Africa rising from an outside perspective, because the money that is generated in Namibia mainly benefits external interests and a very small local elite. But unfortunately, while the average annual per capita income is around $9,000, estimated 50 to 60% of the population still lives in absolute poverty. We have 5 to 6% of the Namibian local population in control over more than 80% of the annual expenditure, private expenditure. So it's a society that is marked by gross inequalities, which is a contributing factor to the frustration mounting on the ground, that people still are often hungry. We had people last year starving to death in Namibia, in such a rich country, so that observers critically concluded this is a rich country with poor people. Mm-hmm. It really depends on the perspective. If you are a potential foreign investor who wants to make money through investment in the resource exploitation, then Namibia is a good place. If you're one of the locals who is unemployed, and it's estimated that between 30 and 40% of the population is unemployed, and in the age group until 25 years of age, it's estimated that it's up to 70%, then your assessment is most likely not that positive.
So they must import some of its food from abroad.
They do. They import a lot from South Africa. Mm-hmm. But that also depends, of course, to the climatic factors, that it's a semi-arid to arid country, and there's very little productivity in agriculture except cattle ranching and similar small cattle and related activities. So Namibia will never be self-sufficient in food production, but that is partly a result of the climatic conditions.
So you said unemployment rate and poverty are the main points of criticism for many Namibians or for the opposition.
Yes, and according to the latest survey of the Afro Barometer, mm-hmm. The electorate ranks as a top priority to fight or reduce unemployment and to fight or reduce poverty. These are the top issues for the electorate.
Professor, what are the challenges facing Namibia's Namibia president-elect Hage Geingob?
The main challenge is indeed to reduce the gross inequalities. Mm-hmm. Another challenge might be to reconcile the inner party factions. SWAPO has been always marked by internal power struggles, not so visibly the most recent years, but there are different factions in party, and Geingob, coming not from the most influential group from the north, will need to show that he deserves the name of unifier by also unifying the different factions in the party. But he has the capacity to do so. He is, as I mentioned, very clever, a very sophisticated, and at the same time a very street smart person who clearly could have the potential to achieve such a difficult mission.
Professor Henning Melberg, extraordinary professor of political science at the University of Pretoria and the Center for Africa Studies, University of the Free State in Bloemfontein. Thank you for being with us. Thank you, professor.
I thank you.
Thank you.